Welcome to CBTV. Thanks for joining us. I'm Kelly McDonald.
On this campus, you're watching CBTV.
Welcome to CBTV. Thanks for joining us. I'm Kelly McDonald.
And I'm Joseph Corral. 15 laptops were stolen over the weekend from the homes of Cal Poly students. The burglaries happened on Foothill, Hathaway, and Buena Vista Avenue.
San Luis Obispo police are investigating the burglaries as an organized theft ring.
I felt extremely violated. I didn't feel safe in my house. We didn't know who was in our house and why they would do that. And the worst part was we knew they had been watching us because how else would they know we had left?
In addition to their laptops, Carlisle and her roommates had several laptop chargers and iPods stolen from their house. Wallets and other valuables were not taken from any of the residences. They think the robbers broke into the house by either picking the lock on the back door or coming through a window that was unlocked. Before you leave for winter break, SLO PD recommends making sure your home is secure and consider taking expensive items with you over the break.
One of the biggest stories of the quarter was California Proposition 30, which aimed to raise taxes on those who make over $250,000 a year. CPTV reporter Ed Zucchelli looked into the worries Cuesta College students and professors had if Proposition 30 had not gone into effect.
Teachers and professors at Cuesta College are getting ready for the possibility of more budget cuts. Cuesta is facing the possibility of 29 programs being cut on campus if Proposition 30 does not pass. If it does pass, it is likely they will see some programs go away anyways.
You know, what are we going to be in the future? Is that all we're going to, Cuesta College is going to be? You're going to have composition and basic math? Is that all you want?
One of the programs on the list to be cut is the Broadcast Communications Department at Cuesta.
Well, when I heard that it might be cut, I was very shocked. Especially still being in the program and counting on that as my major.
A panel of faculty, staff, administrators, and a student will make a recommendation to Cuesta College President Gil Stork as to what will be on the chopping block in November. The Board of Trustees will receive the final recommendation from Stork on December 12th. Some programs could be cut as early as the spring 2013 semester.
The other thing that they said, the programs could be saved as long as the community considers them valuable.
Cuesta College could lose over $2.8 million if Prop 30 doesn't pass. That's on top of the $3 million cut the college has made already.
I would very much like to say that I was able to get a broadcasting degree from Cuesta College.
Ed Zucchelli, CPTV.
Well, Proposition 30 did end up passing, with just under 53% of the state voting yes. The proposition will give Cal Poly students a $166 one-time refund because the previous tuition increase was cut. Prop 30 goes into effect in January.
Over 100 people came out for the last open meeting of the Semester Review Task Force. Faculty, staff, and students attended the meeting held Thursday in Chumash Auditorium. President Jeffrey Armstrong and Provost Kathleen Enns-Finken took questions from an audience that wanted answers. Throughout the meeting, President Armstrong stressed that the decision to change Cal Poly to a semester system is not a done deal. A major concern of many faculty members is the potential increase in workload. The task force chair, Rachel Fern Flores, said the recommendation will be available to the public by December 11th.
We had the opportunity to interview President of Dwell Media and Cal Poly alumna Michaela O'Connor Abrams. Dwell Media is an award-winning design and lifestyle media company based in San Francisco. The company has grown from a magazine to producing an annual design conference and exhibition called Dwell on Design, the biggest modern design show on the West Coast. Abrams gave advice to journalism and design students regarding how to succeed after graduation.
So one of the most important things in this journalism major is your ability to spread your wings with those elective units, taking business courses and psychology courses and graphic communications and making sure that you are really well-rounded.
For journalists, how important...
CPTV did our most comprehensive coverage of election night ever. The most memorable part of the night was our very first live shot at San Luis Obispo Mayor Jane Marks's victory party at Big Sky Cafe. CPTV reporter Christina Favuzzi interviewed Marks about her win that night.
how are you feeling as the numbers are coming in?
Very good. Thank you very much. It's looking very positive. So right now I've got 65% of the mail-in votes, and I'm hoping that the poll voters will also follow suit.
CPTV political reporter Lindsay McLeod anchored live updates that streamed on campus and online throughout the night. Brandon Jones directed, and Ed Zucchelli was the executive producer. PG&E tried to conduct seismic tests off the Central Coast to see how strong of earthquakes could occur near the Diablo Canyon nuclear power plant. After a new earthquake fault was discovered offshore of the nuclear power plant, plans were made to investigate. Low-level seismic tests were conducted, but ultimately the debate came down to whether PG&E tests would harm the sea life. The U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service looked to test the sea otter population to see if they would be affected by the testing.
But we don't know, and that's why we're doing studies, to find out if that is indeed happening, and to, if it is, to let the agency know and to publish that information.
CPTV reporter Lindsay McLeod has a story as to why the California Coastal Commission ultimately turned down PG&E's application to conduct the seismic tests.
Located near the shoreline in Hawsbury Faults, PG&E's Diablo Canyon nuclear power plant was built to withstand a 7.5 magnitude earthquake. Getting a better picture of how a major earthquake would impact the plant has been a plan since 2006. But the tsunami off the coast of Japan in 2011 created a renewed sense of urgency for seismic testing. Using high-frequency air cannons, the company planned to map the fault lines and assess seismic risks along the central coast. But environmentalists and others concerned about the potential harm on marine life put up a fight, and on Wednesday, they won.
This commission denies the permit application.
Their main issue? The lack of details. The commission questioned the technology as well as whether or not PG&E had provided the community with enough proof that the tests were necessary.
But I've just not been convinced that the benefits of this work justify the potential risks or costs to our environment and to the unknown, the unforeseen and unintended consequences that may exist.
For many, the decision was cause for celebration. But others worry the lack of knowledge on our fault lines could prove devastating in the case of a major earthquake.
In doing so, you end up having an entire fault area not being seismically tested. And it being right next to a nuclear power plant causes quite a bit of concern for someone who's from here and lives here and has to deal with that my entire life.
PG&E released a statement regarding the Coastal Commission's decision. Quote, PG&E put forth a sound and comprehensive plan to conduct this research, which was guided by seismic experts, state and federal agencies, and our commitment to performing the work in an environmentally responsible manner. So is this the end of seismic research? PG&E says no. Quote, the proposed survey is only one component of our larger, multi-layered seismic research program. PG&E recently completed on and offshore studies to learn about the Central Coast's geology. Lindsay McLeod, CPTV.
Well, the monarch butterflies are back on the Central Coast. The Butterfly Grove in Pismo Beach will remain open 7 days a week until February. Volunteers will be giving daily talks about the butterflies every day from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. The butterflies will be spending the winter in Pismo because of the warmer microclimate. Cal Poly students will be doing research on the butterflies throughout the winter. They tag the butterflies with a little piece of paper that has a phone number and an email address on it. The tagging is done to keep track of the butterfly migration. NBC correspondent George Lewis spoke at the Alumni House on campus in honor of International Education Week. CPTV reporters Olivia Bickle and Christina Favuzzi talked with Lewis about his career.
I think of that Johnny Cash song, I've Been Everywhere, Man. My career spanned 42 years at NBC. I've been to all 50 states and 30 plus foreign countries, covered a lot of big international crises. I was in Beijing for the Tiananmen Square revolt in 1989. I was in Iran in 1979 for the hostage crisis when the Iranians captured those American hostages. So, you know, I've been to a lot of upheavals around the world. The one thing that sticks with me the most is probably the fall of Saigon, because it was Vietnam where I started out, and I sort of came full circle with that, observing the end of the war, and then being able to go back to Vietnam numerous times since then to see how the country has fared in the aftermath of war. It's something that was a seminal part of my development as a journalist, and something that always will stick with me. My favorite thing about journalism is being able to uncover things that help people, hopefully make the world a better place, that shed light on public problems. Also, I'm a product of the California State University system, and I feel like I have a need to give back. You know, a lot was given to me, and I like to help other students, not only in the state university system, but elsewhere, get their start.
The Argo. It's based on the Iran hostage crisis that Lewis reported on.
Tensions in the Middle East flared 2 weeks ago when Israel and Palestine resumed fighting. CPTV reporter Brandon Jones takes a look at the student perspective of this divisive conflict.
The most recent conflict in Israel and Palestine does have one thing in common: different views on the nature of unfolding events. This disagreement starts on when this conflict began.
That Israeli missiles assassinated a leader of Hamas.
But it was a defensive mechanism because Palestine has been firing rockets into Israel for like over 10 years.
Palestine wanted to, of course, respond to this action, so they sent rockets of their own.
And the disagreement continues today, after the UN granted Palestine non-member observer state status by a wide margin yesterday. A decision which gives Palestine greater access to international criminal courts, as well as a step closer to full sovereignty.
No decision by the UN can break the 4,000-year-old bond between the people of Israel and the land of Israel.
All people cling to the right to defend themselves against aggression and occupation.
Today's unfortunate and counterproductive resolution places further obstacles in the path to peace.
And some students have a personal connection to the conflict.
A lot of like Jewish students at Cal Poly, they have friends in the IDF, which is the Israel Defense Force, which is their army. So a lot of people have friends and family in Israel.
We have students from both sides. They have family ties, they have religious ties, they have community ties.
But all sides agree that peace should be the goal, however unlikely it might seem. Students and staff alike stress that awareness and education are the keys to enacting real change in the ongoing conflict between Israel and Palestine.
The Students for Justice and Peace in the Middle East, they've been putting on documentaries talking about the whole conflict.
If each side can educate people about what's happening there, hopefully we get to a point that American people start asking the questions.
CPTV, Brandon Jones.
Well, coming up next on CPTV, we have reporter Olivia Bickle live in the Poly Plant Shop.
Hi, here in Winter Wonderland at the Poly Plant Shop. And I'm surrounded, as you can see, by these beautiful poinsettia plants. And after the break, we'll be talking to one of the students who helped to grow every single one of these plants. So stay tuned.
Back to CPTV, Cal Poly gets very festive this time of year.
We have reporter Olivia Bickle live in the shop right now. All right, how's it looking, Olivia?
I'm here at the Poly Plant Shop with Becky, one of the students who actually helped grow all of these beautiful poinsettias. So tell us about what this sale is that's going on right now.
Well, this is a joint sale between the Poly Plant Shop and the Cal Poly Poinsettia and Fresh Project, which is a student-run, or student-produced organization. We grow all the poinsettias, and now we're doing a sale of the poinsettias.
Okay, and how long of a process was it to get all of these poinsettias to their beautiful state?
Well, we started a lot of stock plants in January, and then we started all of the newer cuttings, which are the smaller plants, and that started in June.
Okay, and how much is it to come in and buy a poinsettia plant?
Well, we have a lot of different prices, starting from $55, which would be something like this, and then we have a $5 plant, which is in a 4-inch pot.
Okay, that sounds awesome. So, what do you recommend for Cal Poly students who are looking to get a gift? Do you recommend
come by. So definitely come by and check out our poinsettias. We have over 30 different varieties in all different sizes, and I'm sure your parents will love them.
Great, great. Thank you so much, Becky. And you can come by, stop by until you said December 14th, and buy a beautiful poinsettia plant. They're great for gifts, and you'll be supporting local Cal Poly students. Back to you guys at the desk.
Thank you, Olivia. You know, I actually checked it out last week, and it's really a sight to see.
Yeah, they look holiday cheer in there. Anyways, there's only 20 days left before Christmas, and that means Santa is a busy man. Although he's making a list and checking it twice, you can go tell him what you want for Christmas at his house downtown in Mission Plaza. On his first day in San Luis Obispo, the Friday morning after Thanksgiving, Santa visited with 263 kids. Santa will be in Mission Plaza until noon on Christmas Eve, which is cutting it close to his annual flight.
Well, my reindeer are out by Creston. Okay. They're out at a ranch by Creston, and they're having their buddy Scotch oatmeal cookies for dinner.
Hi there, how are you guys this evening?
Every child who visits with Santa would get a candy cane, a toy, and a coloring book, all at no charge. You can also get your picture taken with the man in red for $5 with your own camera, or for $7.50 for a souvenir frame photo taken by his elves. After your visit with Santa, you can ride the carousel that will also be in Mission Plaza starting this Monday and running through December 24th. You can find Santa's hours as well as the carousel's hours at downtownslow.com, or you can call 541-0286. Going from the big man in red who gives out presents to local students who give out free food to partygoers on Hathaway. The group is called Jesus Burgers, and it's made up of a Christian students who pass out free hamburgers. They have been passing out hamburgers in Cedar Creek since spring of 2010, but they have a new location now on Hathaway. Jesus Burgers is completely student organized and led, but it is financially supported by Slow Crew. The group started at UCSB, where they have been operating on the party streets of Isla Vista for the past 10 years.
Get in their lives a little bit, and they're always just like, why are you guys giving us free burgers? Who does that? And so we just jump in and just go, well, this is a representation of God's gift of salvation. And yeah, it's just awesome to get to know students more.
Jesus Burgers currently operates once a month, but they want to start serving bi-monthly if funds permit.
Well, Slow residents got a look at some alternative fuel cars at Farmer's Market.
From the outside, this may look like a regular car, but what powers it is truly unique. That's because the Farmers Market hosted a green car show this week, organized by the Central Coast Clean Cities Coalition in honor of National Alternative Fuel Vehicle Odyssey Day. Members of the coalition brought their cars to Higuera Street to show off their modified vehicles.
Well, I have a plug-in hybrid, a Prius, 2009 Prius, that was converted to plug-in hybrid, meaning it can get about 20 to 25 miles on a full electric charge.
Among those that attended the event was Cal Poly Mechanical Engineer student Carlos Guzman, who along with other students modified a go-kart to run on electricity.
It's pure electric, it runs two independent motors that are 50 horsepower each, and they each drive the wheel independently, so there's no connection between the two rear wheels.
Some of the most distinctive vehicles featured at the event was a car that gets 100 miles per gallon and a motorcycle that runs on methanol.
Probably doesn't help much, but I'm the one that drives by the gas pumps when the price goes up and I say, yes!
CBTV, Armando Garcia.
You can contact the Central Coast Clean Cities Coalition on their website, c5.org, for more information about alternative fuel vehicles.
Slow Ocean Currents, a local dive shop, held a unique contest this Halloween. Divers met at Target Rock in Morro Bay to compete in an underwater pumpkin carving contest. The event consisted of two dives. The first dive was a scavenger hunt for orange-painted rocks, and the second dive was an underwater pumpkin carving contest. Divers were allowed to hollow out the pumpkins before diving. They had 45 minutes to carve out the best they could with whatever tool they wanted to use. Most divers either used their dive knife or a pumpkin carving knife. Once the divers got out of the water, the pumpkins were judged and prizes were given out to the winners. The prizes consisted of a free boat trip and scuba gear. The manager of Slow Ocean Currents says that carving a pumpkin underwater is not easy, and it is best to have a plan before getting in the water.
One unique club in San Luis Obispo gathers at Santa Rosa Park every Saturday. You may have seen them wearing medieval attire and swinging homemade fake weapons. They aren't violent, they're Amped Guard players. Amped Guard is a role-playing game where people get to put their everyday life on pause and trade it in for roles as barbarians, warriors, and wizards.
Using my spellbook, I've been trying to either capture their teammates and make them my hostages, thereby I kill them and then raise them as undead minions. And what you see me did a lot of was flying. I literally fly and get to point and say, haha, I do this, bah, and then not a lot of people can hit me.
Well, it looks like fun, and you can join in on the live-action role-playing every Saturday afternoon at Santa Rosa Park. Bring your shields, bring your swords, and bring your game face. Well, coming up on CBTV, we'll tell you how men's basketball made history.
Welcome back. We have Kim Westland here with us to tell us what happened with sports this quarter.
Let's take a look at our fall sports that made history. The Cal Poly men's basketball team is still on a high after beating nationally ranked UCLA. CPTV reporter Ed Zucchelli gets the reaction from the players.
Muhammad on the weak side. Drew to pull the trigger.
Three ball.
Three.
For the win, no!
All the credit in the world to the Cal Poly Mustangs. What an unlikely comeback.
The Mustangs did what seemed to be a long shot by upsetting the then 11th ranked Bruins 70-68. This was Cal Poly's first defeat of a ranked opponent since the Mustangs returned to Division I basketball 19 years ago.
That shows a lot about the character of our young men that we recruited and what a great coaching staff we have that helped put that game plan together that ultimately won the game.
The win put Poly at the top of the headlines in the sports world and on social media. Immediately after the win, Cal Poly was a trending topic on Twitter, and the game was even featured at the top of the broadcast on ESPN SportsCenter.
11th ranked UCLA getting Cal Poly on Sunday night. They do it from Poly Pavilion.
That's kind of something you grow up with as a kid. It's like, oh man, I want to be on SportsCenter. So I mean, we have a lot of older guys on the team, and you know, we were happy they were finally able to get that done.
Senior guard Dylan Royer made a career-high 6 3-pointers that led him to receive his first Big West Player of the Week honor.
I mean, I'm a shooter. I'm not much of a ball handler, passer, or rebounder type of guy. So basically anything that I do is all it's all because of my teammates.
So during the break, Kelly, you told us about how you used to be a superstar athlete.
Well, I don't know about that, but back in middle school, I played some basketball and they nicknamed me Shaquille O'Neal.
That's awesome. Well, the Cal Poly football team's remarkable season is over. They lost to Sam Houston State by a score of 18-16 last Saturday. The Mustangs finished the season 9-3 for the first time since 2005. The Mustangs share the Big Sky Conference Championship title in their first year in the conference. Cal Poly is already getting ready for the next season when they return 18 starters.
You know, my aunt goes to church with Brian Bennett on the basketball team and sends congratulations our way from Chicago.
Sweet.
That's cool.
Okay, well, up next on CPTV, we'll take you inside a local brewery and you'll get to hear the sounds of a patriotic ensemble.
Well, welcome back to CPTV. You know, there are a lot of great local entertainment events this quarter.
Yeah, there were, and we have some highlights of those events in your Pollywood Minute.
Well, students got to take part in a celebration of Latino Heritage Month. The Multicultural Center hosted an in-depth look at Latino dancing. A group called Itzacoatzli took over the UU with their Aztec footwork and drum beats. Throughout the performance, the group paused to discuss their technique and the meaning of their costumes. They explained how they danced to honor their ancestors and indigenous roots. Their members included Cal Poly students and alumni.
Also, the U.S. Air Force Band and the Singing Sergeants came to the pack. Tickets for the concert were free and it was a full house. The band performed a variety of music from patriotic to classical and even some of their original songs. The program titled Air Power was the part of the band's West Coast tour. Air Power is designed to portray the excitement of flying in the Air Force. The audience got to witness the world premiere of two new pieces. A group of students from SLO High School were invited to play one song with the band. All of their performances are free and open to the public.
An award-winning Central Coast brewery retains top honors from the most prestigious beer competition in the world. Well, I'll let you take this one, Kelly.
Yeah, totally. The world-renowned music and dance troupe Stomp came to the PAC this fall. The performance was a two-night event. In addition to the percussion, group's usual trash cans and broomsticks, they used new props such as tractor tire inner tubes and spray cans. The group performed to a packed house both nights.
All right, well, that's going to do it for us today.
Yeah, you can watch us online at mustangdaily.net/CPTV.
Well, you know, I was thinking about the Hispanic dancers, and that really resonated with me, being Hispanic, and I thought that was a pretty cool story to cover. The garbs and everything they were wearing were incredible.
Yeah, the sounds in the background really added to the story as well.
Exactly. Well, from all of us in Studio 300, have a great break, happy holidays, and see you in 2013.